The disadvantages of dynamic CMOS have to do with the high impedance node that occurs when we are trying to evaluate a 1. Specifically, that it is very sensitive to any sources of interference that take away charge. Here we're not talking about random noise, we're talking about systematic sources that affect the output node. Specifically, we're talking about leakage, charge sharing, and the effects of cascading. We will begin by discussing the effects of leakage on dynamic nodes. Leakage is a phenomenon through which current flows in a MOSFET, other than the drift current that flows between the drain and the source when the transistor is on. More colloquially, we use the term leakage to refer to current that flows in an off transistor. So when a transistor is cut off, we expect the current flowing through it to be null. In other words, we expect its impedance to be infinity. We have so far assumed that the impedance of any cutoff transistor is infinity, and that our own only problem has to do with the on current of the transistor refusing to be null. However, there are sources of leakage, specifically three sources that we will discuss in detail in module 10, that cause a transistor to cause a small, though finite, current to flow when it is cut off. In other words, its impedance are off will not be infinity, but will be a high value. We're talking something in the gigaohm range. So how does this affect us? This affects us by the fact that we're depending on the fact that there is an open circuit in all directions, so that we had a perfect open circuit when we were trying to evaluate a 1 in a dynamic circuit. So this was a high impedance node that kept the charge on the capacitor, allowing us to have an output value of VDD. Again, when did this occur? It occurred when we were trying to evaluate a 1. So let's look at the case when we are trying to evaluate a 1. So in this case, the clock was 0. The output managed to precharge up to VDD. It was doing so through a low impedance path through MP. It has done so. We entered the evaluate phase. Input is equal to 0. And therefore, in this case, we are ostensibly looking at a situation where there is an open circuit from the top and the bottom. The PMOS is off because it is we are in the evaluate phase, and so the PMOS doesn't exist. And the NMOS in, the NMOS MN is also cut off because the input to this transistor in this phase is equal to 0. Recall, however, that the tail NMOS transistor MN is on because clock is equal to 1. And so when we were evaluating here, we expected to evaluate VDD and the VDD to remain constant because there's nowhere for the charge to go. Now, if there is leakage, this means that a finite current is flowing through this NMOS transistor and a finite amount of leakage current is flowing through it. If we assume that this leakage current is a constant equal to I naught, then there is a constant current source, I naught, eating away at the charge on the capacitor CL. If we look at the capacitor voltage-current equation, the current in the capacitor is equal to CdV by dt. So if leakage is constant, this means that dV by dt, the rate of change of voltage with time, is going to be a constant. This means that the voltage at the output node is going to drop in a linear fashion at a constant rate, and the rate of dropping, the rate of decrease, is I naught over C. So why does this affect us? Why is it bad? It's bad because we no longer observe a V output high that is equal to VDD. In fact, we observe a V output high that is constantly degrading. And so the question is this a big effect? Can we tolerate it or can we not tolerate it? When is it a big effect and when is it a negligible effect? And the answer is it all depends on the slope of the straight line. And so if the slope is large, then that means that the voltage drops precipitously. If the slope is small, then the opposite is true. So the slope consists of I naught over C, right? And so for the slope to be small, either I naught is going to have to be small, which means a small leakage. And the problem with that is that leakage is more or less proportional to the size of the transistor. And so we do not have full control over that. And another factor that could affect leakage is also C. If C is large, then leakage is going to be slower. And that this is actually the first case in which we see a positive impact of capacitance. So if the capacitance is large, then we need more charge to cause it to have an output value of VDD. This means that if we eat at this charge with the same leakage rate, I naught, it will take longer to impact the voltage on this capacitor. But we cannot say that increasing the value of capacitance is a method of controlling leakage, because increasing capacitance also increases delay. It increases both pre-charge delay, because we need to put more charge on the capacitor in the first place, and it also increases evaluate delay when we are trying to evaluate zero. So why are we only concerned with the case where we are evaluating a one? Because this is the only case where the output node is high impedance. Does this mean that leakage does not affect nodes that have a low impedance path to supply or ground? Of course it does. It even affected static CMOS. But in static CMOS, there was always a path to supply through the PMOS. So even if there was a leakage current flowing through the off NMOS when we were evaluating a one at the output, the on current from the PMOS was more than enough to counteract it, and we barely saw the effect, except maybe in terms of some power dissipation. So how do we deal with leakage? There are two ways to deal with leakage. Either accept that it's going to happen, and then what this does to you is that it imposes a maximum time that you can spend and evaluate. So let's call that T evaluate max. How can this be calculated? Let's for example, assume that we can only tolerate the output high that is greater than or equal some value called the output high minimum. So our perfect or ideal value for the output high is VDD, but our lowest acceptable value for the output high is the output high minimum. Don't be confused and use the input high for the output high minimum. The output high minimum should be a very high value, because this is the acceptable clean value of one for us. And so this is going to give us delta V. If we substitute in the current voltage equation of the capacitor, I naught over C, delta V, then T, or delta T, will be T evaluate max. And so we can get T evaluate max from this equation, and it gives us the maximum amount of time we can spend in the evaluate phase. And so T evaluate max plus T precharge is going to give us a maximum period for the clock. And so the clock has to be smaller than this value. But the clock also had to be greater than T evaluate plus T precharge, which we calculated in video two, in video three actually, which was the delay video. So we have two limits for the period here. And this limit is actually kind of strange, because it's the first time we see a maximum limit imposed upon the clock period. This tells us that there is an F minimum, which is equal to 1 over T evaluate max plus T precharge. And yes, there is a minimum frequency at which we have to operate, otherwise the circuit is going to fail. This is a feature of dynamic circuits in general, that they have a minimum operating frequency, and we're going to see it very clearly in dynamic RAM in module 12. So another solution for leakage is to use something called a charge keeper. This is a solution that is kind of, I would call it lame. So, I mean, it's an interesting solution in theoretical terms, but it has little practical value. So the problem here is, recall that the problem only occurs when we are trying to evaluate a one. And the reason that it occurs is that there is leakage through the pull-down network that is not being compensated by anything, because the PMOS transistor is cut off. And so what do? We add a new PMOS transistor. Let's call it MKP for M keeper. And this PMOS transistor is gonna connect the output node to the supply voltage instead of the pre-charged transistor MP. So this keeper transistor has to work conditionally. So its gate voltage has to be conditional. It has to work only when the output is trying to be evaluated at one. Unfortunately, the gate of the PMOS is active when the input is zero. So if the output is VDD or one, and we want this guy to work, then we have to use an inverter here in the middle. And this inverter has to be a static inverter. Otherwise, we have embedded the problem of leakage inside this inverter. So it has to be a static inverter. So there's a bunch of problems with this solution. First of all, we can contest the fact that we are using three transistors, two from this inverter and one from the keeper, just to make this network work. And so now the inverter has six transistors instead of three, whereas the static CMOS inverter has only two transistors. But this can be answered by the fact that the overhead of these three transistors remains constant regardless of the type of gate we are trying to help here. So when the main gate itself becomes larger, the number of transistors in the main gate is n plus 2, and it's 2n in the CMOS gate, and we have three additional transistors, that's okay, right? So it's not a huge overhead. The problem here actually is that we have a feedback path. This is the main problem with this. And whenever we use something to solve a problem, we have to go and check that the cases which did not have a problem, the cases that were not problematic, have not now been complicated. And so we did not have a problem while pre-charging. We will still not have a problem while pre-charging. In fact, this transistor is only gonna help in the pre-charge. We did not have a problem while trying to evaluate zero, because while trying to evaluate zero, we had a low impedance path to ground through the pull-down network and the transistor NN. But in this case, we will have a problem while trying to evaluate zero. The problem is, while trying to evaluate zero, the output node starts at VDD because we have just come in from pre-charge. And so the node always starts at VDD. And what's happening is that the pull-down network is trying to discharge this node down to ground. Normally, it will just be, its current will be doing nothing but discharging the capacitor, which is why it is superior to static CMOS, because it doesn't have any short circuit current. The entire current is devoted to discharging the capacitor. But in this case, this node is at VDD. This causes the gate of the PMOS to be at zero, and so the keeper is on, and so the keeper will still continue to push current. And so even though the pull-down network is trying to discharge, the keeper doesn't really know that this is the pull-down network. The keeper thinks this is huge leakage, and so it keeps charging this node, right? It sees a drop across its source and drain, and it keeps charging this node. This causes short circuit current flow, which causes power dissipation and also increases delay. Notice that this will not keep happening forever. As soon as the output node drops enough, the output of this static inverter will switch from 0 to 1, and the PMOS keeper will stop working and will stop opposing the pull-down network. However, we have added a lot of delay to the evaluate phase. How can we ameliorate this? How can we make it a little bit better? First, we make the keeper a very weak transistor. We use a minimum size transistor for the keeper because all it has to do really is compensate leakage current, which is really small. And we need it to be weak so that it doesn't fight against the pull-down network. We can also use a VM that is higher than VDD over 2, actually close to supply voltage. And what this does is, as soon as this output node drops, you know, comfortably below VDD, the static inverter understands that we are trying to flip the output instead of leakage, and so it switches its output to 1, and it shuts down the keeper. And so this is one of the cases where it's actually useful to have a static CMOS inverter with a skewed logic threshold, not a logic threshold that lies close to VDD over 2. The closer to the supply this logic threshold, the sooner the keeper stops fighting against the pull-down network. But the more the possibility that noise or leakage can cause the keeper to also stop working. So it's a trade-off.